Something. An achievement is one of the best things that makes us wake up in the morning. And when we are going to work, everyone wants to achieve something. When you go to school, when you go to place of work, and everything that you do, you always want to achieve something that will be tangible and that you are going to leave a legacy in your life. I want to bring to you a story that was told one time by one of the professors who said that he remembers one of the greatest men called Edmund Hillary. Edmund Hillary was one of the greatest achievers who achieved one of the hardest and difficult things in life. This man was the first man to attempt to climb Mount Everest. Those who know Mount Everest, and I've learned about Mount Everest, it is 29,000 feet high. And Edmund Hillary tried to climb that mountain. In the year 1952, he was not able to climb. But when he looked back, he saw the picture of the mountain, and he talked to the mountain and said, "You, Mount Everest, you beat me once, and I will beat you twice." Edmund Hillary, the following year, 1953, he tried to climb the mountain, and he said, "This is an achievement that I have achieved." Today, friends, I stand here to bring to you a message entitled "Fundamental Characteristics of Great Achievers." Fundamental characteristics of great achievers. And this is what we are going to read in the book of Numbers. In the book of Numbers, chapter number 14. The book of Numbers, I think all of us, we can go there. In the book of Numbers, chapter number 14. And we are going to read a few verses from verse 21. This book, the book of Numbers, is one of the books in the Pentateuch, and this book was written to reaffirm the promises of God to Israelites as the nation that God has chosen. And when you read very well from the book of Genesis to the book of Deuteronomy, you find that the Lord was just raising a nation for himself. But we can ask ourselves, if the nation of Israel was risen, or God had risen the nation of Israel to achieve his God through it, then is it that he left the nation? And we can answer no. The tribe of Israel was the fundamental tribe that the Lord was following so that he may achieve his redemptive plan. He plans to redeem us. He plans to give us salvation through the same nation. And then when you read the book of Numbers very well, you find that it had two generations. And these two generations, we will come to learn about them as we continue. And now, when you look at the book of Numbers, you can find that God was trying to bring into attention the promised land that he had promised them. And now when you read in the book of Numbers chapter 14, I want to read briefly because we read another text, but I want to read in the book of Numbers chapter 14, verse 21, 22, 23, and 24. And this is what the Bible says. Nevertheless, as surely as I live, and as surely as the glory of the Lord fills the whole heart, not of those who saw my glory and the signs I performed in Egypt and in the wilderness, but who disobeyed me and tested me 10 times, not one of them will ever see the land I promised on oath to their ancestors. No one who has treated me with contempt will ever see it. But because my servant Caleb has a different spirit and follows me wholeheartedly, I will bring him into the land he went to, and his descendants will inherit it. Since the Amalekites and the Canaanites are living in the valleys, turn back tomorrow and set out towards the desert along the route to the Red Sea. Let us pray. We thank you for your word. I stand before your people and I pray that, Lord, you make me a mouthpiece and a spokesman for your glory. I pray that the Lord, God of Moses, Isaac, God of Jacob, will speak to us. It is my prayer, O God, that you are going to give us a new dimension of thought, a new dimension of attitude, that we may change and have a new perspective in achieving our great goals. Thank you for everyone. I pray that, Lord, you are going to make us to open our ears, and we are going to rebuke demons and powers which come to steal our attention. It is my prayer that, Lord, you are going to stand with us, and the Spirit of God will walk with us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. As I say that, church, I've come to submit to you fundamental characteristics of great achievers. It is, I began, I said that each and everyone always works to achieve something. When you have a family, you have something that you want to achieve. I gave an example of Edmund Hillary, who wanted to achieve a goal that was never achieved by any person in the world. And when he was beaten by the first challenge, he did not go back, he did not retreat, but he continued to work hard so that he may achieve the goal of climbing Mount Everest. And today, as I have suggested to you, that there are some fundamental characteristics which we as church members, as Christians, we should have. And the first one, the first fundamental characteristic of a person who wants to achieve something is the attitude of that person. That is the first thing, the attitude of that person. Our attitude can determine our altitude and our length, our distance where we can go. And I want us to read the same verse that I've written, I've read in verse 24. But because my servant Caleb has a different spirit, that is what has touched me this morning. God is talking to the people of Israel. After exploring the land of Canaan, the 10 spies went, but one of them, we call Caleb, came with a new report, who was filled with a new spirit, and he comes with an attitude which was positive. The attitude of Caleb is the one that made him to know that they can enter the land. The other men came with reports, and the people of Israel, they began to murmur, and they murmured and say, no, we are not able to enter the land. Why? Because we have seen men who are like great men, and we are like grasshoppers before them. But Caleb, if you read the book of Numbers chapter 13, verse 30, the Bible says, and Caleb silenced the people before Moses and said, we should go out to take possession of the land, for we can certainly do it. That is the attitude in his heart that is working for him. And I want to suggest to us all that if our attitude will be positive, there will be nothing that will be impossible before the Lord. Bwana Yesu asifiwe. If our attitude is positive, everything before us will be doable. The other thing that we have seen through Caleb is that when Caleb heard the murmuring of the people, after silencing them, he suggested to them and he told them, now because the land has been promised to us, let us change our attitude. Whenever we are doing things, every time we are doing things, we are performing, we want to achieve something, first of all, we should engage ourselves into our activities which will bring our attitude to be growing every day. We need to change our attitudes and make our attitudes to be positive. Even if the thing you know it is not possible, you just change the attitude and make the attitude to be very positive in your life. Number two, the other thing that is important as we want to be great achievers is keeping the records of achievements which are past. Keeping the records of achievements which are past. I know most of the people say that I will not dwell on the past, but I want to give you an example of a man in the Bible who is called David. In the book of 1 Samuel chapter 17, the Bible says, chapter 17, verse 7, the Bible says, and David was ready to face Goliath because he knew that he had killed a lion and a bear. And when I was trying to read the verse, I understood that it is important for us to keep the records, the victories of our yesterday. And if yesterday you succeeded, you need also to take that record and use the record of yesterday, reverend, and make sure that you win the victories for tomorrow. So David said, I killed a lion and I killed a bear. So today I am ready to be helped by the same God to face this Goliath. So the victories of yesterday can help us to win the battles for tomorrow and today. But yes, was it given? Every time that we look at things and we see mountains before us, it is our time to use the records which previously we have seen victories in our lives. And even we can use the records of other people who have the same word that we have, who are serving the same Lord, and say, because my friend succeeded yesterday because of the same God, because the Bible says Jesus is the same yesterday, today, and forevermore. I want to follow the path that I followed yesterday, and I'm very sure that I'm going to win. I'm going to be victorious because the victory does not change, but the victory will come because the man or the owner of the victory does not change, and Jesus does not change in our lives. So we can win the battle by using the records of yesterday or using the victories which we had yesterday. That is the second point. The first point I've said that as great achievers, we need to have positive attitude. Number two, we should have that kind of mentality that if yesterday I won, today I'm able to win. And that is the word that David told Saul. Saul was not ready to release David for battle. But David said, now, because I won yesterday and I killed a bear, the same thing, the same formula, the same God will help me to win the battle for tomorrow. Friends, I know most of the times we want to achieve something. As Christians, we are achievers of great goals. But most of the important thing that we can achieve is to touch lives of other people. I am very sure that we as Christians, we have opportunities to touch lives, but we don't know where can I start. You can fear because maybe you are not appealed to a certain formula that you can use. But the Lord is telling us as Caleb, He is telling us because of our attitude, because we have Him, we need to use Him and also apply everything using the tactics which He has given us. I remember that when Caleb here is talking about victory, he has read the history about the children of Israel. And when I was trying to read, I saw these people, when God Himself delivered them from Egypt, they passed through many things. Caleb could see them passing through the Red Sea. He counted them using passing through Rephidim. He saw God doing a miracle in Mara. And God is trying to help them to remember that the same God who helped us in the Red Sea, the same God who helped us in Mara, the same God who helped us in Rephidim can help us even to conquer the flesh. He is able to help us to enter the land of promise. Our dear friends, I want to suggest to you that because God has promised us that we are going to rejoice together in heaven, what are the things that we are supposed to do so that we may enter the place? Because heaven is there, and we always talk about the place, New Jerusalem, where we shall rejoice together. But what are those things that we should do? I have said that as Christians, we need first of all to examine ourselves, to examine our hearts, to examine our attitudes, so that when we prepare to go to the New Jerusalem, we must set our pace, we must change our attitude. We should have positive response. Whenever you see somebody, even if that person has hurt you, what kind of response do you have? When you see somebody in a problem, do you help that person? That is the happening for us to go. That is the happening for us to achieve. Because great achievement in Christianity, I would say that it is great, it becomes great when we touch lives. When we touch lives, it becomes the greatest and profound achievement in our lives. Brothers and sisters, when you received Christ, how many lives have you touched? In the place of Job, have you ever suggested the promotion for someone? Those who are in school, have you ever touched life of another student? Pastors, what have we done to touch lives? Are we touching lives? That is one of the most important questions that today we should ask ourselves. I was trying to think, why should I achieve my own things, yet I don't achieve for the honor and glory of the name of the Lord? I remember Maurice Olow, reverend, once said that if you soil your hands for the comfort of others, then God will wash every mess in your heart. For example, his suggestion was, for example, we have the big sandal here, and you come in the morning, you wash it, you make it clean. We come to sit here comfortably. Then the Lord in heaven will see what you have done, and He will cleanse some messes in your family. He will cleanse some messes in your heart. So if we touch lives and we work for the comfort of others, then God will come for our comfort. May I hear an amen. Amen. If we touch lives, and I want to repeat that, if we touch lives, if you see your brother thriving, let your attitude be positive. If you see your sister thriving, succeeding, make sure that your attitude is positive toward that person. And after your attitude is positive, then God Himself will come for your rescue, and the attitude of God will be towards you, and things will change abruptly in Jesus' name. So I want to say this, because there is no time. As a ministry. Reverend, look at when I came here, I saw a ministry of great achievement. What are you specific? I saw a great team, praise and worship. I saw many choirs. We are men of great achievement. We want to raise the ministry in our families. As we raise the ministers in our families, I want to call upon each and everyone that we may raise the ministers in the church. When I use the word, even let us be people who can give time, people who can give God the best, people who can have positive attitude toward the things of God. That is why God sent man, we call a guy, and he told a guy, go and tell the people of Judah, I rescued them from the captivity in Babylon. And they have started to work to build the temple. But they have stopped. And now God is telling a guy, tell the people to consider their ways. Consider your ways. So look at your friend and tell them, consider your ways. We need to consider our ways. How? Are we working for the betterment of God? Are we working for the betterment of others? Or are we trying to raise up the ministers in our lives, not touching the lives of other people? Jesus is an example who was very much opposed. He worked day and night to touch lives and to change the community because he was a great achiever. We need to be examples and embodiment of Jesus, who is the embodiment of wisdom. He is supple in grace. He is the epitome of knowledge. And when he pours the knowledge to us, he is the same God who will make us to touch lives and to change other people's, even opinions of other people. And they change the attitude of people. Hata kama mtu anakutukana, usikimbie na umwambie ni sawa. Just take time and try to show him vile amefanya ni mbaya. Ndio a change the attitude. Bwana Yesu asifiwe. And we are going to be great achievers. As a pastor, what can I do to become a great achiever? My soul, my body, my everything. I should work for the betterment of the word of God. We should work hard and wake up and pray for the church so that our words can reach other people who are perishing around here. I remember Reverend was preaching about the demographics, and you said in Umoja, the people did you alisema kuna pattern ya nini? Watu wa Umoja ni wale. Sindio? So what are we doing to change the style and the lives of the people at Umoja? Because Reverend, you said that so as Christians, as people of great achievement, the first achievement is that we touch the lives of the people around Umoja that they may change from that behavior. That is what we are supposed to do. And when we touch their lives, then God will touch even the invisible lives which are associated to us. So I want to say that as great achievers, as great achievers of Umoja, we need to have a positive attitude. We need to know that our attitude will determine where we can go. We need also to remember what God did yesterday and the success that he got. If you were one time, you were sick and you prayed, and God answered your prayer, then today you tell God, I know that you healed me. You healed my son. You can do more. You can greatly heal the land of Umoja. Praise be to Jesus. So as I conclude, I want to say that we as Christians, so that we may become great achievers, we need to work hand in hand to touch lives and to work for the comfort of others. And God himself is going to touch our lives. He's going to cleanse our messes. As he's going to advance us. And we are going to shine even in the darkest place. May God bless you. May God be with you. I call upon Elizabeth to pray for us.
Let us pray. Our Lord, Father, King of glory, we say thank you for this opportunity. Thank you for your word, Lord, because it comes with a purpose, my God. May you continue speaking to us, our Father, because there is none like you, your Father. We need you more than yesterday, your Father. Continue ministering to our life, your Father, because you are waiting upon you, Jehovah. Without you, we cannot make it. Our righteousness, Jehovah, cannot make us to come before you, Father. We say thank you, we worship you, and we honor you. We exalt your name, Jehovah, Father. We decrease so that way you may increase the glory. Be with us and help us. Minister to our life. Through the name of Jesus Christ, we do pray to us. Amen.